The easiest method to use to calculate objects with transient conduction is to use the lumped capacitance method. However, if the Biot number, which is equal to the convective heat transfer coefficient times some length divided by the thermal conductivity, if it's greater than 0.1, now we need to consider that temperature gradients within the solid are no longer negligible. And so if this is the case, now our temperature is a function of our x, time, our initial temperature, our bulk temperature, our length, our K, our alpha thermal diffusivity, and our H for a plane wall. So the method used in this screencast is obtained by non-dimensionalizing the governing equations. Let's see how to do that. First, we define a non-dimensional temperature that we call theta star. This is equal to our temperature minus our bulk temperature divided by the initial temperature minus the bulk temperature. We then define a dimensionless time, which is equal to our thermal diffusivity times our time divided by L squared, and this is also known as the Fourier number. And finally, we define a dimensionless length, x star, which is equal to the x, where we're looking, divided by the L, and for a plane wall, the length of the plane wall is defined as 2 times L. And now we rewrite our heat equation and initial and boundary conditions. So now that we have our theta star as a function of all dimensionless parameters, x star, the Fourier number, and the Biot number, we can use this to get an exact solution. So the temperature distribution is in the form of an infinite series that looks like this. And remember, this is for a plane wall with a length of 2 times L. However, if we have a Fourier number that's greater than 0.2, we can use what's known as the one-term approximation. And so what that means is that instead of having n equal infinity, n just equals 1, and we just look at the first term. So what are these? So this term is an eigenvalue, and our constant is a function of that eigenvalue. So let's take a look at what the one-term approximation looks like, and we'll write it out in terms of what we're interested in. So t minus t infinity divided by ti minus t infinity is equal to c1 times the exponential of this first eigenvalue squared times the Fourier number. And this is multiplied by the cosine of this eigenvalue times x divided by L. So how do we find this C1 and this eigenvalue? Well, we refer to a table that has these numbers as a function of the Biot number. So what you do is you calculate your Biot number, and by the way, this is just a piece of the table. You have Biot numbers that go a lot higher. And for that particular Biot number, you find your eigenvalue and you find your C1, and then you put it back into this equation to solve for whatever quantity you're looking at. Let's go through a couple of different scenarios. So let's start with here, A. Let's say you want to find some temperature at a certain depth in your solid at a certain time. So how do you do this? You calculate the Biot number, then you look up your eigenvalue and your C, and then you use the one-term expression and solve for T. This is, of course, assuming that you have everything you need to solve for the Fourier number and that you have your initial and bulk temperatures. Let's look at B. So now what you want to do is find the centerline temperature. In other words, where x equals 0. And again, remember the length of this plane wall is equal to 2L. So in the center, x is going to equal 0. So we're going to use the same equation as we have before. However, because x equals 0, x star equals 0, and therefore this cosine term is going to end up equaling 1. So to find our temperature in the center, we just calculate it like this. In fact, we have a dimensionless form of this equation just for the center line temperature. So now what happens if you want to find a time where you have some temperature, you know the depth, etc. Maybe it's the center line temperature. So where do we find time in this particular equation? Well, that comes from the Fourier number. So if you remember, that's what's known as the dimensionless time. So if we're going to have to calculate the time, we're going to have to calculate the Fourier number first, and from that, get time, just like this. So I suggest that you solve for your Fourier number first, and then solve for your t, rather than putting it all in one equation. And the reason for that is, remember, to use that one-term approximation, the Fourier number has to be greater than 0.2. In our other situations, we are given or can calculate the Fourier number before we even begin. So here it's important, when you get to that step, to check for your Fourier number. In subsequent screencasts, I'll show you how to apply these techniques that we've just gone over to examples.